Hey everyone, welcome back to Instrumentation Lectures. In the previous lecture, we had studied about the different methods of measurement. In this lecture, we are going to classify the instruments on whether they are absolute or secondary, analog or digital, automatic or manual, mechanical, electrical or electronic, self-operated or power-operated, and finally on the method of measurement which we covered in the last video. Okay, so let's start our lecture. The first way to classify instruments are based on whether they are absolute or secondary instruments. Absolute instruments give the value of the quantity that has to be measured in terms of physical constants and their deflection only. These instruments do not require calibration and therefore does not need comparison with other standard instruments. An example of absolute instrument is tangent galvanometer, which we use in our labs to dictate if there is current or to dictate the direction of a DC current flow. The tangent galvanometer gives the value of current in terms of the tangent of deflection produced by the current, the radius and number of turns of the wire used, and the horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field. As you know, the galvanometer only gives us a deflection theta due to the current, and we need to manually calculate the value of current using the equation I is equal to 2RVH by mu 0 into N into tan theta, where R is the radius of turns, VH is the horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field, N is the number of turns and theta is the deflection produced. So, here we are getting the measurement I in terms of instrument constants and deflection theta. Okay, secondary instruments on the other hand are so constructed that the quantity can be measured by observing the output indicated by the instrument. These instruments need to be calibrated against an absolute instrument. Some examples of secondary instruments are ammeter, voltmeter, wattmeter, etc. Now, these absolute instruments are seldom used except in standard institutions. This is because working with absolute instruments is time consuming, as every time a measurement is made, we need to manually compute the magnitude of quantity under measurement. Due to this reason, secondary instruments are widely used in everyday work. Next, we classify the instruments on their mode of operation, and the two modes are analog and digital. Analog instruments are those instruments that produce analog signals as output. On the other hand, instruments which give output that varies in discrete steps and has only a finite number of values is known as digital instruments. Although digital instruments are more accurate and has higher resolution, they have many drawbacks like lower sensitivity and higher cost when compared to their analog counterparts. So, when it comes to choosing between analog or digital devices for measurement, we weigh in factors like accuracy, power requirement, cost, sensitivity, and portability, and decide one depending on our requirements. Now, going to the next mode of classification, which is based on the functions performed by the instrument. They are indicating instruments, recording instruments, integrating instruments, and controlling instruments. Indicating instruments indicate the quantity being measured, generally in a LCD screen or by means of a pointer which moves on a scale. Examples are ammeter, voltmeter, wattmeter, etc. Next, we have recording instruments. Recording instruments continuously record the variation of any physical quantity with respect to time. In principle, these are also indicating instruments, but so arranged that a permanent continuous record of indication is made on a chart or dial. The recording is usually done in digital form or by sketching on a graph paper which is rotated on a drum at uniform speed. An example of recording instrument is the ECG machine we use in hospitals to record cardiac rhythms. Integrating instruments, on the other hand, totalize the events over a specified period of time. No indication of the rate or variation or the amount at a particular instant are available from them. A commonly used integrating instrument is the energy meter in our homes, which shows us the consumption of total quantity of electricity during a particular period of time. Finally, we have the controlling instruments. In this case, the information is used by the instrument to control the original measured quantity. An example is electrical relays. Nextly, we classify instruments based on whether they are automatic or require manual supervision. In the case of manual instruments, the service of an operator is required. An example is a traditional weighing scale. Meanwhile, automatic instruments does not require an operator. An electronic weighing machine is an example, as it indicates the weight without requiring any manual assistance. Now going to the next classification, based on the process we can classify instruments into mechanical, electrical and electronic instruments. If the process behind the working of an instrument is mechanical in nature, we call that device a mechanical instrument. These instruments are reliable for static and stable conditions. Also, they are cheaper in cost and durable. However, mechanical instruments also have some major disadvantages. As they have moving parts that are rigid, heavy, and bulky, these instruments possess high inertia and therefore are unable to faithfully follow the rapid changes which are involved in dynamic and transient conditions. Another disadvantage of mechanical instruments is that most of them are potential source of noise and thereby cause noise pollution. Some examples of mechanical instruments are vernier calipers and screw gauge. Now, electrical instruments are those devices that use electrical methods for indicating the output. However, in most cases, these systems depend upon a mechanical meter movement as indicating device. For example, although an ammeter depends on electrical methods to produce the output, the indication is shown using a mechanical pointer. This mechanical movement has some inertia and therefore these instruments have a limited time response. So, when we need to measure rapidly changing responses, we use electronic instruments. Electronic instruments uses semiconductor devices. Since the only movement involved in these instruments is that of electrons, the response time is extremely small owing to the very small inertia of the electrons. Also, with the use of electronic devices, even a very weak signal can be detected by using preamplifiers and amplifiers. An example of electronic instrument is the Hall effect current sensor. Now the next classification of instruments is based on their power usage. We have self-operated and power-operated instruments. Self-operated are those which require no outside power for operation. It draws power from the measuring environment. They are also called passive instruments. For example, in ammeters and voltmeters, the meters take power from the system under measurement, right? Now, power-operated instruments are those in which external power supply is required for operation. They are also called active instruments. For example, in the case of an electronic weighing machine, we need to plug it into a 240-volt supply to operate it. So, here we are taking power from the supply and therefore is a power-operated instrument. Also, please note that active instruments need not be always electrical. It can also be hydraulic or pneumatic. Now lastly, we have our instruments classified based on methods of measurement. We had discussed about the methods of measurement in the last video. So if you do not know what are the different methods, please do watch that video first. Okay, coming back, we have mainly two categories, deflection type and null type. In deflection type instruments, the magnitude of the unknown quantity is indicated by the deflection of a pointer. Examples are ammeters, voltmeters, wattmeters, etc. However, in null method, a zero or null indication leads to the determination of magnitude of unknown quantity. An example is determination of unknown resistance using Wheatstone bridge. Here, we connect the unknown resistance to one leg and adjust the resistances of the other leg so as to make the current through the galvanometer zero. Or in other words, we are nullifying the indication of the galvanometer. Also, please note that in cases where high accuracy of measurement is required, we use the null method. Okay, that's all for this lecture. To summarize, we studied about 7 ways to classify the instruments, that is, absolute or secondary, analog or digital, automatic or manual, mechanical, electrical or electronic, self-operated or power-operated, null or deflection type, and finally, indicating, recording, integrating or controlling type instruments. If you have any doubt, feel free to ask them in the comments so that either me or some other viewer can help you. In the next video, we will discuss about units of measurement and applications of measurement systems. Thanks for watching and have a nice day.